Welcome to How I Built My Fundraising Consultancy, the stories behind the people driving results in the nonprofit sector.
Scalability plus quality control. I'm quite a stickler about quality. And as a result, I'd rather sacrifice scale for quality because reputation is everything, both personally and for the firm. And I want every client to be happy, and we always want to exceed expectations.
Hi there. Welcome to How I Built My Fundraising Consultancy. I'm Tim Chatton, Marketing Solutionist at MarketSmart. Today on the show is Larry Raff, President of Copley Graff Incorporated. Larry has extensive experience helping healthcare-related organizations raise funds and led a $200 million campaign entitled The Only Cure is a Remedy for the Juvenile Diabetes Research Foundation. Today's interview, you'll hear about the benefits of running a consultancy with a team of consultants supporting you instead of just yourself. You can find more information about Copley Graff Incorporated at www.copleygraff.com. Here's my interview with Larry. I'm here today with Larry Raff of CopleyRaff.com. Welcome, Larry.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Tim.
So let's get started with a little bit about your background. So Copley Raff has been around 9 years now, and prior to that, you worked with Goodwill, BD's, Oregon Food Bank. Tell me a little bit about your background.
Well, after getting my master's in public health and clinical nutrition, I got into food banking when food banking was really getting traction in the Reagan administration. And I took off from there and basically have been a senior fundraiser, VP level or president level for about 20 years before I became a consultant. And that included a national campaign for the Juvenile Diabetes Research Foundation.
Fantastic. Yeah, and I saw that. It was a $200 million campaign. What kind of things did you learn during that process of doing that?
I worked in the northeastern U.S., so I basically had seven campaigns going with each of the chapters in major cities, Baltimore and north. And what I learned was it's okay to leverage the relationships of others to ask for large gifts, even though I did not even know the people I was speaking with asking them for a gift. I was able to do some very significant fundraising using relationships of others associated with the organization. And that was very meaningful.
Can you give me an example of a phone call you'd use?
Well, I always did face-to-face. For instance, in Pittsburgh, I sat with a volunteer in a social club, and prospects would come in. We'd sit, we'd chat, we'd ask, they'd leave. And we would do that for a better part of a day and literally raise a couple of $1 million.
Wow. Yeah.
From people we really did not know.
But they knew your organization.
They knew the organization, they had a relationship with the chapter, and they showed up to the meeting based on that, knowing what was going to happen.
Fantastic. You've worked with in a lot of different verticals prior to your consultancy. Did you have a favorite industry to work with?
Yeah, healthcare is really my strong suit. As I mentioned, I have a master's in clinical nutrition and very facile in communicating with physicians and translating medical issues, research issues to the layperson. That's probably my most comfortable space. Mm-hmm. So I've done a lot of work in human services as well.
Okay. And that's something you probably take to your consultancy as well and try to approach healthcare related nonprofits as well?
To be sure.
Okay.
A fair amount of our business is with hospitals, multi-hospital systems, and allied healthcare professions.
Okay. Fantastic. Now, I noticed at your time at Goodwill, you were media and community relations as well as the fundraising component. What kind of things did you learn dealing with the community and media?
Well, clearly, the media has probably more to do with just making board members and volunteers feel good about the work they're doing with the organization. And uniquely about Goodwill, clothing donations were very important. So having the public have a constant reminder about that also fed the other part of the business. So they were hand in hand, and the position spanned both that and fundraising appropriately.
Okay. So as you went between your different jobs, did you notice common challenges you ran up against trying to accomplish your job of raising funds?
A theme throughout is always leadership. And it's executive leadership, it's board leadership, and the ability to both get decisions made in a timely manner that are sustainable decisions so that you can go out and raise dollars around them with confidence, and knowing that the dollars will be used appropriately is often a challenge I found when I was on the front lines as well as a consultant. And I don't see any sector where that's not an issue. quite frankly.
Mm-hmm. Now, you started your consultancy about 9 years ago or so. Did you wake up one day and say, hey, I want to do this as a consultant? Or what was your motivation to get started with that?
Well, actually, my situation is a little different in that I was recruited by the principal of a consulting firm in 2001, early 2002, mm-hmm. called Copley Harris Company. I became a consultant and VP of the firm and served as a consultant for about 6 years. The principal wanted to retire, worked it out where I actually purchased the firm. Now, that was in January 2008. Right at the beginning of the Great Recession.
Perfect timing, right?
Yeah, wonderful timing.
Yeah.
Don't ever get investments on my tips. But in effect, I was having to start from scratch in many ways because of the huge disruption the recession caused, and had to rethink everything, redesign the way the firm had been working previously because it just was a different day.
Yeah, and a lot of your clients left you at that time because of the economy?
Well, not so much left, but it was bringing in new clients was definitely a challenge because everybody was retrenching. Mm-hmm. And frankly, the model changed too. The prior model was often a resident model where a consultant would essentially become part of the staff to do a campaign, for instance. That has changed dramatically since the recession. And the nature of engagement, both my firm and many of the firms that are in the marketplace, have really changed the model in many ways as a result of that.
What's the new model?
The new model is, I think, more purely consultative, where more reliance is put on staff as opposed to a on-site embedded consultant, mm-hmm. serving the role of a staff person.
You'll train the staff to do what you would have done, basically?
Essentially teach them the fish,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
Rather than give them a fish. I've always been a proponent that you've got to build internal leadership, and to bring a consultant in, do a campaign, and then leave, leaves the agency actually more vulnerable than if you do the hard work of training up staff and letting them go beyond the campaign.
And what is your business model?
It depends on the project. If it's for instance, a campaign study, that would be project-based. It would be a flat fee. We anticipate how much time it will take us, et cetera, and we charge a fee for that. Campaigns or general counsel build program would be a retainer basis. We decide on a work plan, get the client to agree to the work plan, and then we would propose a fee, agree on the fee, and then spread it out over a period of time, 12 months, 24 months, so forth. And then on occasion, we'll be called back in for one-off consultations or particular training programs that we do, and that would be on a per diem. So it really does vary across the board, and it seems to work pretty well.
Okay.
Now, I would say that the retainer approach also puts the burden on the client as well, because they have obligations to get things done and to follow the work plan. Mm-hmm. So if they know they're writing a check to Copley Raff every month, they're going to be more motivated to get the work done.
What is your getting started process for new clients? Do you have a meeting with them and evaluate where they're at?
Absolutely. Can't go in blind. And typically, not at all uncommon when a client says, hey, I need a feasibility study, or I need a this or that. We come in, do an interview, and realize it's really not what they need, or they're really not ready for that yet. And so it is relatively common for us to propose an alternative to the RFP that they may have put out, for instance. So the intake is very, very important. It's become clear to me over time that people who are too close in really can't see the forest for the trees. So it needs outside eyes and expertise to help them understand what they really need.
Okay. What are your most popular services, or what do you recommend to most of your clients as a first project that you do with them?
It's advancement planning, because you've commonly heard the term audit, where an organization brings in a firm to audit their fundraising operation. I hate the word, for one thing.
Mm-hmm.
And secondly, what good is an audit if it doesn't come with some follow-on strategy to do something about what has been found? So we incorporate an assessment into our advancement strategic planning. And that way, if we're able to come up with go-forward strategies, go-forward organizational structures, assessment of the team, helping the team leaders put people in the right places to really amplify their brilliance in what they're able to do well, then sky's the limit. Then you can begin doing things like campaigns, like building a major donor pipeline, all the things that we do, like preparing for a campaign. But until everyone's on the same page and everyone's agreed to a go-forward strategy, your chances of success really diminish.
Okay. You mentioned purchase consultancy around the time of the recession. What approach did you take to get new clients during that time?
Well, one thing I did was I started a blog, and I was always a blogophobe.
Yeah.
So the social media, remember, this was in 2008, so social media was still getting traction.
Yeah, the iPhone was a year old at that point, and Twitter was very, very early.
That's right. So I started dabbling in it, but I really jumped in full force in around 2010, and I've been blogging ever since and have actually generated quite a following. So obviously that's one method. Training at conferences is another. My website's very important. I've done a third now revision of my website in the last 9 years. So that's got to be fresh and enable the visitor to find what they're looking for quite directly. I have a pretty robust email list that I communicate with. So it's really multi-channel, but at the end of the day, much of the business comes from referrals from past clients, board members, people I've trained, and occasionally through directory, cold call kind of inquiries that result in business.
Okay. Did you have any mentors to run your business and getting advice from to be successful at it?
I had mentors in the fundraising side, to be sure. But in terms of business itself, I wouldn't call them mentors, but I certainly had advisors who helped me with some key decisions, including the consultants on my team. These are very capable and bright people who have really stuck with me the whole time. And so I listened to their advice closely and have enjoyed a fair amount of success as a result.
Okay. So you mentioned there's a team of you. How many consultants are at your consultancy?
We have 11 consultants on the team, and they bring various strengths and expertise to the table. You know, I don't use everyone for all engagements. It's really a what's appropriate fit, who's available, et cetera. And I would say that all have been with me since 2008 or have come on since then and remain. So it's a nice, stable cadre of folks, and they really know their stuff. I have found that going in as a solo practitioner into an engagement increases the level of risk the client is taking, because there are many consultants out there who may be in between jobs, for instance, or aren't sure they're in the business. They want to be in the business. So they could exit stage left with a new job offer and leave the client high and dry. So with a firm, that can't happen, won't happen, doesn't happen. And while firms may be a bit more expensive, I think, than a solo practitioner might be, what comes with that is depth of bench, depth of experience and tools that I think more than compensate for the extra dollars.
And other consultants can promote within to a client. If someone's working with that client, they can say, oh, that's not my expertise, but this guy is brilliant at it. He'll do the job really well for you.
That's exactly right. So we may come in and find that, you know, your direct mail program needs to be bolstered. I'll have a whole separate company called Rising Tide Direct that does direct mail, direct marketing. We may find that your data analytics need some work. So there's someone on the team with that expertise. Change agent organizational development work or branding and marketing. That's all depth that we have and can bring to bear as we move through an engagement.
Yeah.
So that's very important to be able to have.
The consultants you purchased, was it just you and the partner? And then in 2008, you brought on a lot of different people and changed kind of how it was structured? Or were there a lot of people back then as well?
Yeah, there were 5 or 6 people, consultants on the bench and a couple of staff people. And the recession, et cetera, some people went their own way. Model changed. So I would say there's one consultant who is with me from prior to the time that I purchased the firm.
Okay.
But she had come on just before that happened.
Yeah. With the knowledge you have today, if you were starting back in 2008, is there anything you'd change from what you did?
I'll tell you, it was such a chaotic time. Then the fact that I survived it is, I did something right. No, we had fortunately had a couple of large clients in healthcare, which really did not take the brunt of the hit in the early days. So that was able to help us get through. But I probably would have acted more quickly about reorganizing staffing structure and so forth. I probably waited longer. That was wise in retrospect. But beyond that, no. And remember, too, back in 08, 09, some of the promotional tools were not really readily available. You know, LinkedIn was probably in its nascent form, if it was even active at that point. Just the whole constellation of outreach has changed dramatically since then.
Yeah, in the beginning, how much, I guess, physical advertising or promotion did you do that wasn't digital?
I did some, but frankly, it just did not bear fruit.
Yeah, okay.
The big firms have the budget. You know, some of them work for publicly traded multinational corporations. So they have the budget to continually be out there in the marketplace advertising and to burnish their brand. I focus more on professional conferences, both displaying and presenting when at all possible.
Mm-hmm.
That often bore quite a bit of fruit. My training programs are very well received and people tend to remember what they saw when it comes time for thinking about consultants.
Yeah. Now, with the number of consultants you have on your team, I'd imagine that allows you to have more capacity.
Exactly right. Scalability plus quality control. I'm quite a stickler about quality. And as a result, I'd rather sacrifice scale for quality because reputation is everything, both personally and for the firm. And I want every client to be happy, and we always want to exceed expectations. The tools we use are well-worn and designed in-house, and people pretty much know the game plan for how we do certain things, obviously adjusting to the circumstances on the ground. For the most part, best and effective practices are used that we have found, and they're constantly evolving and adapting to the demands of the day.
I see. Will you turn down clients?
We've turned down clients because of the nature of the organization, the nature of the leadership, or them seeing consultants as the messiah that will solve all their problems.
That they won't need to do any work once they hire you.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Do you employ any virtual assistants or assistants?
Yes and no. I mean, consultants do self-sustaining. Mm-hmm. I outsource, you know, bookkeeping and web work and marketing work. Some of that's outsourced. But for the most part, these days, the need for court administrative assistant kind of position is much less than it used to be. And the need for that isn't very common.
Okay. The blog you mentioned earlier, is that something you write or is that outsourced?
No, I write all of it. There's a rare exception here and there, but it's a great release for me to be able to think about things in depth and to articulate them in writing. And I typically share them via LinkedIn and my email list and obviously on my website. You know, I've got a very nice following. And good news, too, is that I'm in meetings with clients or potential clients. I can refer to posts that I've done on the subjects that are important to the conversation and share them to help people get clarity about what the issues are and to obviously burnish my credentials in that area.
Now, as you go through your working life, do you have a running note that just has ideas for blog topics as you run across them in life?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. I have many yet to get into the can. I just actually launched one today. But often, I'm stimulated by what I see in the world and what I read in the papers and connect dots. Fundraisers cannot be monochromatic. We need to know the world and know what our donors are interacting with. So that's what the blog hopes to do.
Okay. What's been your biggest mistake you've made during operating your consultancy, and what lesson did you learn from that?
I occasionally strayed from the game plan, from the business plan, to explore new lines of business that I thought might bear fruit, and some have, but most haven't. But that's the way entrepreneurs work. If you get 1 out of 5 or 1 out of 10, consider it a success. But you always learn from it and integrate what you've learned into making what you do better. But end of the day, understand what your core business is, understand what you do well, and really dig in on it.
Yeah. Now, what are you most proud of over the 9 years operating your consultancy?
We've helped a lot of organizations. It's really gratifying when we can move the needle for a particular organization or within a particular space, an industry. And so that's always gratifying. You know, we've turned a lot of shops around. We've completed many campaigns, and that's gratifying. And frankly, my blog post is a source of pride. And we've also been doing a 4-day master gift officer training called Plan MGO that we had a 9-year run with that has generated a nice alumni base and people who have clearly been inspired and transformed in their professional work. And that's gratifying as well.
When we return, a quick lightning round with Larry. First, a quick break. You'll learn how to access a free textbook from Dr. Russell James. Today's free resource is a PDF download available at imarketsmart.com/textbook. We here at MarketSmart partnered with Dr. Russell James to offer his fantastic book entitled Visual Planned Giving, An Introduction to the Law and Taxation of Charitable Gift Planning. Here's what the book includes. The Secret to Understanding Planned Giving, A Super Simple Introduction to Taxes, How to Document Charitable Gifts, Valuing Charitable Gifts of Property, Special Techniques for Donating Retirement Assets, Private Foundations, and Donor Advised Funds, and much more. Visit imarketsmart.com/textbook to download your copy. That's www.imarketsmart.com/textbook. With that, let's get to lightning round with Larry. What's the best piece of business advice you've ever received?
Stick to what you do well.
What piece of advice would you have yourself as a 25-year-old?
As a 25-year-old, I started fresh in that I had a house fire and got wiped out. If you're hungry, it's a good thing because failure is not an option. Have a plan, work your tail off, and don't be afraid to take risks.
What book would you recommend to those getting started and why?
To be honest with you, I don't any longer really read books in the professional realm.
Mm-hmm.
I rely a lot on current day articles, occasional blog. I also look up a lot of research. I use Google Scholar a fair amount, and I look at topics and see what the peer-reviewed research is generating in terms of that. And again, reading Wall Street Journal and Washington Post and Chronicle of Philanthropy, the New York Times, etc., they do a lot of coverage that's important.
Do you have a favorite personal productivity habit?
Things that I can get done immediately, I get them done. And when I know I've got looming deadlines, I try to get a jump on the project in rough form so that when deadline comes closer, I've gotten most of the work done. If you're able to get your core thinking done first, then you're able to do the enhancements and the more creative thinking without the pressure of deadline.
What's the best under $100 purchase you've made in the last month or so?
Oh, my mechanical keyboard.
A clicky-clacky keyboard.
The clicky-clacky keyboard.
Nice.
It's great.
Excellent. What's an interesting or fun fact about you that most people don't know?
That I was a registered dietitian, as I mentioned, but I'm also colorblind. And I have an undergraduate in graphic art.
What's one of your most important passions outside of work?
Well, not to be too cliche, but family, obviously. Politics. I'm sort of a politics junkie. Politics is a large bearing on the industry. An exercise. Got to exercise. Otherwise, you're going to not do yourself any favors in the long run.
Do you have a favorite word?
I do. To spare you the Yiddish, I like the word brilliant.
Desk or car, what would you clean first?
Desk, but both are pretty damn clean.
Do you have a favorite animal?
Well, I've always lived with dogs. They help, I think, reveal your soul.
Tea or coffee?
Coffee. Chewier the better.
What do clients never ask you that you wish they did?
What challenges have you overcome? The challenges that people have faced tells you a lot about them. And how they've overcome them tell you even more about them. And I often ask that of others.
What is the most common error you see nonprofits make?
Recruiting the wrong people for boards and some key positions, not vetting properly. And this is a particular bug of mine of late, is management training. Fundraisers get promoted into management positions, but have never been taught how to manage.
What charities do you admire or support?
I tend to support advocacy and democracy promoting organizations, ACLU, Lambda Legal, Public Radio, that kind of thing. They're dynamic, they're ever-changing, they make some very significant national differences in pretty short order.
Now, where can people find more information about your consultancy and services?
Well, please visit my website, copleyraff.com.
Well, thank you so much, Larry. It's been a pleasure.
Likewise, very much.
Thanks for listening to this episode of How I Built My Fundraising Consultancy, presented by MarketSmart. If you like the show, make sure to review it on iTunes and pass it along to a friend or colleague. If you're curious about what we do, make sure to check out imarketsmart.com. And don't forget to download your free textbook by Dr. Russell James by visiting www.imarketsmart.com/textbook. Thanks for listening.